I'd like to now introduce today's expert, Carol Huneycutt. It is such a pleasure to be working with Carol today. Carol's been a great friend to the National World War I Museum and Memorial. She was a teacher fellow in 2016, 2017, has represented us very well at national conferences, and is now part of our Teacher Advisory Council. To give you a little bit of background about our speaker, Carol Huneycutt earned her BA in History from the University of Arkansas, and then a Master's in Education and Gifted Education in 2010. She's taught a variety of social studies classes for the Fayetteville Public Schools since 1993. She resides there in Fayetteville with her husband, John, and three children. And Carol's going to speak to us today about a variety of lessons and activities that she has used, tried, tested with her classes. In fact, many of these are part of a unit for which Carol and her co-teachers and collaborators, Vanessa Seward and Tracy Slattery, won a curriculum award by the Arkansans for Gifted and Talent Education Awards Committee in 2017. I am so proud to have Carol here with us today to provide us with her insights as part of our World War I Changed Us webinar series. Carol, thank you so much for being with us, and I am ready whenever you are for you to share your screen and begin your talk.
Well, thanks so much for having me. It's my pleasure to talk to you today about World War I, and I'm just going to welcome everybody into my dining room and just kind of go through this presentation in a fairly conversational kind of way, talking about what I do with my kiddos in the classroom when we teach World War I. Let's see. All righty. I think I'm up where everybody can see the screen now. And this is teaching to younger students. I teach fifth and sixth grade. I teach a gifted and talented pullout program. My students come to me once a week for 150 minutes at a time. And so I have them for that long chunk of time. It's basically like three or four what might be standard class periods. One of the things that I do is work with students in dealing with abstract concepts. This is something that we put together the second time we've done this unit. I think we've now done this unit three full semesters, I think. And we were looking for, after the first year of teaching it, we were looking for a way to really kind of amp up our depth and complexity, and how can we really bring some more deep conversations with fifth and sixth grade. And so these abstract concepts was what we came up with. Talking each week about some different ideas, things that we can plug into our study of World War I. And we typically do that at the beginning of class. We call them our big ideas. And like, for example, one of the first ones we talk about is, what is patriotism? And we usually have some kinds of questions that we ask the students to try to spur those answers, questions that we can ask that aren't necessarily going to be leading kinds of questions. So for patriotism, I ask them, what does patriotism look like? What does it smell like? What does it taste like? And again, we're just brainstorming, and they've got this space, they've got this little graphic organizer that they have just in their folder that they can turn to each week. And they just jot down some different ideas and we talk about them. I've gotten some very interesting answers on this one. Patriotism, oftentimes they'll say it looks like the flag, or it looks red, white, and blue. It smells like the smoke from fireworks, or it smells like, I can't remember one of the other smells. It tastes like apple pie or barbecue. That was one of, and that may have also been one of the smells. We've got some really interesting kinds of answers. Just to lead into that idea of patriotism. And then you can see down at the bottom of the graphic organizer, there's a space for them to talk about how that abstract concept fits in with World War I. And then as we go through the unit, they could come back and add to that if they see something that fits with that concept later on in another lesson. One of the fun things we added this year was a series of different kinds of bell ringers, truly trying to add some more visual strategies and visual thinking skills into our lessons. And so not every single week, but a number of different weeks, we would put up the name of a person that we wanted them to know and be able to identify for World War I. This example is Kaiser Wilhelm, and they had a little template prepared by one of my colleagues, Tracy, that was just like a little blank person. And we asked them to draw some identifying details on that template of that person and then include that person's name and why they were historically significant. Going more towards the idea of what students in high school would do as that historical identification, but not so much really calling it that. And here's some examples of student work. There's one on Kaiser Wilhelm there. And the students really, really liked drawing, and I was impressed by their ability. If I was given this assignment, I think I would be really frustrated and not be certain. I would pay so much attention to the fact that I didn't think that I could draw. But the students really weren't like that. They were good risk takers, and they really came up with some interesting kinds of drawings for each person. Their favorite thing to look at for each of the people was the mustache, and that became sort of an identifying characteristic for each person, was what kind of mustache did they have. And I did later at the end of the unit, they were quizzed on who these people were and could they recognize them even just by their photos. And for the most part, they really could. Another aspect that we did that sort of carried through the entire semester unit was a choice board of different activities that students could work on when they had free time, if they had finished other assignments. And there were all kinds of different things. There were so many things on World War I that we wanted to study and that we wanted to have the kids learn about, and we simply didn't have time. And so we put a number of those items on this choice board, and they could pick and choose the things that they were the most interested in. There were things that dealt with artwork, with World War I poetry. World War I music was one of our favorites and one of the kids' favorites. We put song lyrics and QR codes to YouTube videos of that played the songs, and they could use a device and go on and scan that QR code and listen to that actual song from World War I. Things like It's a Long Way to Tipperary or Katie. And they were greatly amused by the style of music. They were greatly amused by some of the lyrics, which are kind of humorous. And they, in fact, several classes like sung these songs on a regular basis throughout the entire unit. And we had them do some little activities that went along with whichever one of these they chose. And you can see there that there were different points. We asked them to accumulate 14 points over the course of the semester and told them that at the end of the semester, they'd understand why we were choosing 14 points. And then you can see over to the side, there's this poster that's got rankings, and each of the students in my class, I made a little dog tag for them with their name on it. And they started off as a private, and they, as they turned in assignments, including things off the choice board, they could move up in their rank. And they loved tracking themselves from week to week with where they were in that ranking. One of the neat things that we did, we did this the very first year that we taught this unit, was teaching our students to knit. Teaching fifth and sixth graders to knit is an experience for sure. Lots of students ended up in tears, very frustrated that even though things normally at school come very easy to them, this did not always come easy to them. And then there were some students that this picked it up very quickly. And you can see here, there's students are knitting in class. The first year we asked students to knit a scarf. The first year we asked students to knit a bandage, and that's what this young lady is holding up. We looked for a service project that our students could do that would be challenging, but still doable. And we found a leper colony in Vietnam that was asking for donations of knitted bandages of a certain size, and that's what this young lady here is holding up, is that knitted bandage. The second year that we did this particular unit, we asked students to knit a scarf, and we donated scarves to our local veterans hospital. And then this past year, we asked students simply to knit a square. The knitting portion of this unit became very stressful for some of our parents and some of our students, especially because we asked them to knit something that took so long to complete that we kind of pared it down a little bit. And so we mainly just asked them to learn to knit. Some students really still loved it and did a whole lot with it, and some students didn't, and that was okay. We just asked them to try. Part of the great thing was just giving them something that they could fail at and experience that failure and know that they would still be okay. We began the unit with a lesson on alliances. This is a standard kind of lesson. If you Google different types of activities for the alliance aspect of World War I, this is one that you will find, where each student has a particular color of yarn. They represent a country. I had my students wear headbands. You can see them in that picture down below, where the name of the country is simply on their headband. And they had their yarn. And I went through a PowerPoint lesson explaining to them how the different alliances were formed. And every time an alliance was made, they had to run their string of yarn across to that country that they were making the alliance with. And we did end up with quite the tangled mess at the end, which was the whole point, for them to see that the alliances didn't always make sense, that they were formed between countries that weren't close together, that really seemed to not have that much in common with each other. And it ended up, as I say, quite the tangled mess. We made another graphic organizer for them to keep track of through that alliances lesson, so they could see each country when they entered the war, the reason why they entered the war, if it was because of an alliance with somebody or for some other reason, the side that they fought on, whether they were Central Powers or Allied Powers. And then as we learned about different key people, such as Kaiser Wilhelm, they could plug those into the country where they belonged. And then at the very end of the unit, we could come back to this and talk about each country's post-war condition. So you could adapt this scoreboard in any way that you wanted. If there was other information that you wanted to include, you certainly could do that pretty easily. Another topic that we studied is propaganda. And these are propaganda posters from the World War I Museum and Memorial in Kansas City. That actually is my daughter standing in front of that photo. She was less than thrilled when she saw that I was using this picture of her from several years ago, but I still think it's cute. And we talked about different types of propaganda and why propaganda was used, and looked at propaganda from several different countries. It was wonderful for our students to study this. And then later when we made a field trip to the museum, for them getting to see all of these life-size propaganda posters. This year, when our school went to AMI lessons, when we were no longer able to meet in person, we had studied World War I and propaganda in the fall, and we were in the midst of starting a media literacy unit. And so we coupled those two things together and talked about the fact that there's a lot of news watching going on with the outbreak of COVID-19, and to look for different pieces of propaganda that they saw in the news. What was our government trying to get us to do or not do, or believe or not believe, based on COVID-19, and then comparing that to the Spanish flu of 1918, and comparing that to the propaganda that they learned about in World War I. And so their assignment, or actually, I'm sorry, then I showed them some different World War I COVID-19 posters that had been kind of redone. This is by somebody in United Kingdom who had gone through these British war posters and updated them to be war on COVID, and showed these as examples. Some of them are really quite amusing because they're that World War I picture with the updated COVID-19 information. And then the students were supposed to design their own, design their own slogan or phrase or propaganda poster based on what they thought the CDC or what the American government would be trying to tell our people to do, our citizens to do. And so here's some different things they came up with. I love this one who managed to Photoshop Dr. Fauci on top of Uncle Sam. I want you to stop touching your face. And then one that just simply added the mask and the glove to Uncle Sam. I want you to stay home and sew masks. And then here's some other ones that my students came up with. Just again, following that idea of what we learned about with propaganda when we studied World War I, and then how can we tie that into really what's going on in our world today. Another lesson that we did was on trench warfare, and we did a jigsaw type lesson where students were placed into groups. Each group was assigned a particular topic. You can see the topics in the graphic organizer on the left: rats, weapons, food, gas, disease, daily life. And they became experts on that. And then in a carousel type fashion, students went around to other groups learning about each of these different topics. My students, being fifth and sixth graders, were quite enthralled with trench foot, with rats, with anything that's gross really held their attention, the poison gas and so forth. They say this was a great way to teach this lesson for younger students and not go into a huge amount of detail that is still being age appropriate. The Christmas truce. This was a lesson that we used. We tied in the big abstract idea of humanity. And I showed them the Sainsbury commercial. It's a commercial from England. It looks more like a little movie spot than a commercial, where it shows, you know, the truce at its beginning. You hear it's nightfall over the trenches. You hear singing, and it's first just German singing, and they're singing Stille Nacht or Silent Night. And this shows the interaction between the two sides. It's a very well done little commercial. It's probably 4 minutes long or so. So we watched that. We also have the book Silent Night, Holy Night, which is wonderfully narrated by Walter Cronkite. And then we showed them the DVD of called War Game, which goes along. There's a book with that same name. And that one is narrated by Kate Winslet. It's all animated. It's a wonderful representation of the Christmas truce, and again, told in a way that's really meant for children. I mean, we discussed this, the abstract idea of humanity, and we talked about the things that each side had in common, the fact that they were both singing this Christmas carol, that it was the same Christmas carol, and which meant that they likely, if they were celebrating Christmas, they both, you know, had the same religious beliefs. We talked about the fact that they were showing each other pictures of their families, that they kept photographs of their families with them. So all the different things they had in common, and really that idea of humanity and how they went from that Christmas truce to the very next day shooting at one another again. So led to some really good discussions. Razzle Dazzle. This was a lesson that we stumbled upon quite accidentally. I never knew that ships were dazzled during World War I, that they camouflaged them to try to keep from being sunk by U-boats. And you can see in this black and white photo here, that's actually what the ships looked like. Then we found this children's book called Dazzle Ships by Chris Barton. It's probably my favorite of all of the World War I children's books that I have. It's fabulous, partly because it just talks about creativity and the fact that sometimes we have to do really out-of-the-box thinking to solve various problems that we encounter. And we gave our students, I don't know if you can see this or not, a little template, trying to hold it up here, of different sized ships, and then had them decorate and come up with their own dazzle patterns, which they thought was really fun. Armistice and Treaty. Again, getting towards, this is more towards the end of our semester unit. We talked about armistice and how that went about happening, and then about the Treaty of Versailles. And we had the students do another visual type activity where they had to take this acronym. When we first found this lesson, it was a different acronym. We recreated it to be Hitler and the idea of the Treaty of Versailles really leading to World War II and the rise of Hitler because of the treatment of Germany. And so you can see here in that acronym what each of those letters stand for. And then the students had to make a visual for that, where they had to show each letter and then come up with some sort of visual representation that would help them remember what each of those things stood for. We also had the students participate in a simulated negotiation, and the students again wore headbands for whichever country they were representing at the Treaty of Versailles. Several students were always really excited to be Germany. They wanted to be Germany and be the bad guys for this. And I let them, they volunteered. I quickly let them be Germany. They discovered then later that if they were Germany, they didn't get to talk during the negotiations. They had to sit there and listen and not say anything and then sign off on whatever their cohorts came up with. And you can see from this one picture here, these two girls, they are not happy to be Germany. They also really enjoyed towards the end of the unit being able to wear a mustache anytime that they could. Again, going that came out of that bell ringer activity and really got into the whole mustache thing. There is a video that you can find on YouTube about the top 10 mustaches of World War I that's fun to watch. We did take our students on a field trip to the museum and memorial in Kansas City, which is a fabulous opportunity. If you live anywhere close enough to be able to take this field trip, it is a must. It's about a 4-hour bus ride from where we live in Fayetteville, Arkansas, to the museum in Kansas City. We drive about 2 hours and then have a bathroom break and then drive the rest of the way there. We spend about 4 hours at the museum and then drive the 4 hours back home. So we are gone all day long. We leave Fayetteville at 6 a.m. and we return between 6 and 7 p.m. that evening. On the school bus, we also have a number of parents that come with us. You can see this group photo from posing them outside. One neat thing that the museum offers that they've started offering, I believe, just in the last year, is that if you have if your school is 51% or more free and reduced lunch, then they greatly reduce or waive those admission fees for you. So there are some real perks for if you're one of your schools falls into that category of getting funding to be able to pay for your field trip. Another thing that we did that came out of my fellowship with the museum was looking at actual World War I artifacts. You can find a lot of artifacts to purchase on eBay, which is where each of these things came from. This was a housewife sewing kit on the left, some dog tags or identification tags, and then a bacon box on the right. And we got boxes from like artifact or archivally safe boxes from Hobby Lobby, just made them look like they were artifact boxes, and put an artifact or two in each box, and then put the students in groups, and they had to go through and try to identify what it was using information from there's actually a lesson posted online called Thinking Like a Historian. It's available with the National World War I Museum's education website. It uses some of the Library of Congress materials on how to go through and really analyze something like an artifact. So that's a neat lesson and neat resource there to check out that's on the museum's website. One lesson that I really enjoyed, because this is what I did my research on when I was a teacher fellow with the museum, was talking about animals in the Great War, and looking at the role that animals played in the successes and failures of different parts of the war and how they affected morale. We read a number of different children's books with the students. Obviously, we talked about Stubby because he's one of the more famous dogs. This one pictured here, Rags, Hero Dog of World War I, is a lovely little book with beautiful illustrations. There's a number of other books that are available. These are each ones that I've gotten copies of. The one up in the top left called Soldiers in Fur and Feathers, that's a resource that I used for creating this lesson. I took an excerpt from these books, different excerpts, which showed various animals and gave maybe a paragraph or two of information about a real animal from World War I that doesn't have a book written about it yet. And students were assigned to one of those particular animals and were asked to design a book cover and then also write a summary that would go on the back of the book talking about that particular animal. And Again, they had real books to look at as examples. This is some of what they came up with. Fighting Mac, again, was one of the animals talked about in that book, Fur and Feathers. And a student did the illustrations on the front and a story on the back. And then there was a rubric that went along with that just to help review their artwork, their summary work, and so forth. This lesson is also, an animal lesson is also on the museum's website under the education resources. We did have the privilege of getting to work with the people who made the movie, Sergeant Stubby and American Hero. The movie came out about the time we were doing our first unit study on World War I, and we were able to kind of hook up with them, and they sent us a number of different movie paraphernalia kinds of things and helped us arrange for a viewing for our students at the movie theater when the movie first came out. It's a lovely little movie. It actually, I think, is now either on Netflix or Amazon Prime, one of those things where you can stream it, and if you have that membership, you can stream it for free. I would definitely recommend watching this, and if you have elementary age or middle school age students in the classroom, this is a great one to show because it's perfectly appropriate, and it's fairly accurate in its portrayal of this portion of the war. In Flanders Field, probably the most famous of the poems written during World War I, we did a new version of this lesson this year, which was this one where we asked the students to read the poem silently at their desk. They had a copy of it. Then I called on one student and asked that one student to read it aloud. We listened to a professional reading with this man with this really deep baritone kind of voice. And then there's a song version that's quite lovely of In Flanders Fields that's been put to music. And so we listened to it and we asked the students then to have a discussion about, you know, which version meant the most to them and which one really appealed to them the most and which one did they learn from. It was interesting to see their different opinions. We also in this one, with this particular lesson, used the abstract idea of sacrifice and had some great discussions about that idea of sacrifice and asking students, you know, have they ever sacrificed something for someone else? And, you know, you never know what you're gonna hear, what students are gonna say when you start talking about those abstract ideas. I had one little girl who I'd had for 2 years in class, and I knew that she had lost her mom to cancer a couple of years before. But when we talked about sacrifice in class, something I didn't know about her, she said she sacrificed her hair. And that when her mom lost her hair, that she shaved her head as well so that her mom wasn't having to do that by herself. And I mean, so just the conversations that we were able to have with those abstract ideas as we went along and tried to tie in, you know, the things that we were learning about World War I to make them relevant to our kids' lives was just really fabulous. I also showed them, if you don't know that Charlie Brown visited some of these World War I sites and then recites In Flanders Fields, it's a great little clip to watch. We kind of tried to make things a little bit lighter after that really heavy lesson on sacrifice, and the students did a variety of different kinds of poppy art where we used all different sorts of supplies that we had at our disposal to create scenes from Flanders Field. And those ended up being really neat. This year, we found a World War I escape room. The escape room kind of thing is all the rage lately, and found a free one. And you can see that website down at the bottom, brainyapples.com. This was all put together for you, all of the different things that you needed, except for if you were going to use like boxes with locks on them, which I did order. But everything else that you needed to make the escape room work was already prepared for you. And I was a little worried. I had never done this with my students before, if it would be too hard for them. But they did a fabulous job at this, and they absolutely loved it. So if you're looking for a quick and easy activity to incorporate that's high engagement, this escape room one is a great one. And my last slide on here is just a little plug for the World War I Memorial that's being built in DC that's a part of that World War I Centennial Foundation that Sheree mentioned at the beginning. The architect for that memorial, Joe Weishar, is actually from my hometown in Fayetteville, and he's actually my former student. And he has come and spoken with our GT classes at our middle schools in Fayetteville about his design and his work on that memorial. And so there's information that you can see on that with that World War I Centennial website and the update and progress of the construction of that memorial. And so that is what I have for being put together. So Sheree, I'll turn it back over to you.
Carol, this is really fantastic. And it's just so rich in the number of resources that you are able to bring in and the level of critical thinking that you're asking students to do. I'm curious, how long do you have for this unit with your students?
Our unit lasts for an entire semester, but we only have our students once a week. We do have them for about three class periods once a week. So it's not a full week's worth of classes. And I realize most people aren't going to have that amount of time to put into something. So you would maybe need to pick and choose some of the different activities that you would want to use in the time that you did have.
Which do you feel with your experience with students and seeing what they're able to take away from these activities, which do you feel really achieve your learning objectives the most successfully?
I think the alliance lesson at the beginning is really good with the yarn for helping them understand what alliances are. The trench warfare lesson is one that the students, that's kind of goes hand in hand with World War I. That idea of trench warfare is synonymous with World War I. It's really one of the main times that was used. And so that one's a good one. And then, just adding in from there, they can talk about the armistice and the Treaty of Versailles. For a lot of students, really aren't going to learn about that until a higher grade level, or until they're older. So you might, if you've got younger students, you might want to focus on something more like the animals or that escape room, things like that.
Excellent. Thank you. I love the variety of resources that you introduced us to and the different types of things that you're having students explore. I love that you are really presenting things that I think a lot of folks may not consider kids this age to be ready to use, but I know that you have had, and just looking at the student work examples, some truly excellent work that students turned back in. And I loved too some of your descriptions that with knitting the larger projects came some tears.
Oh yes.
And so very true. Sometimes those things that we think are going to be simpler present some logistical issues. Yes. For those of us who discover maybe we're not quite as talented in some of those areas as we'd hoped.
And what's fun is that, to start with, a lot of the boys are kind of like, well, that's not really something that boys do. But I found that actually a lot of the boys ended up liking it more than the girls did. And, we talked about that hand-eye coordination thing, and that, really got them in there.
That's fantastic. You mentioned something that triggered a thought for me as you were talking about the Christmas truce. And I would like to show a piece of our website. This is available through our online exhibitions portion of our website, theworldwar.org. And we have an online exhibition, so designed to be viewed digitally. And what's interesting about this one is not only are you learning about the Christmas truce, but you're also learning about the debate between historians and the very different stands that some historians have about how accurately the Christmas truce is portrayed some really excellent arguments on both sides, but it's never too early to start introducing our students to the idea that interpretation is not necessarily finite. Mm-hmm. And so being able to take a look at different historians' essays, and then also being able to look at those primary sources to explore the different accounts and the stories about the Christmas truce. And this is also an interesting activity that you can do, especially if you are perhaps in class or looking for an activity right before that winter break. It can make for a day of still learning and still taking those opportunities, but also something that is tied to a holiday, perhaps. And
one of the things we do when we've done Christmas truce is we ordered, I found that you could order boxes, the little Christmas boxes that were given to the British troops.
Princess Mary boxes.
Yes. You can order replicas of those from, I can't remember now the website. They came from the United Kingdom, but they weren't very expensive. So we ordered the replica box, and but the students loved to look at. And then we filled it with just little pieces of Hershey's chocolate, so that they could go around, and as they looked at it, they could have a piece of chocolate, because chocolate was often one of the things that was put in that box to deliver to the soldiers, chocolate and cigarettes. And of course, we told them, we can't give you cigarettes, but we can give you some chocolate. And so they liked looking at that replica.
Well, that brings up another interesting question. As you were talking about working with artifacts within the classroom, you mentioned that some of these can be obtained through eBay and some mm-hmm. different sources. Wondering, what have you found to be some of the least expensive ways, the least money coming from out of teacher pocket, if you will, to find these different artifacts for your use with students?
Well, one of my colleagues, Vanessa, who I think is actually on this webinar with us, she always did a really good job when she contacted sellers on eBay and would say that she was a teacher. Mm-hmm. Teachers don't have very much money, and this was going to be used in the classroom, and would they make her a deal? And almost all of the time, they really did make her a deal. I think one time she had to send somebody a copy of her credentials or something like that to prove that she really was a teacher. But then as soon as she did, he gave her a better price. And then I think also gave information and things that about the artifacts that he might not have given otherwise. Sometimes people will just donate things as well. We also found that our university here in town has a museum, and they had a number of World War I artifacts that have just been back in a storage, just in storage somewhere, not sitting out on display or anything. And the museum curator put together some display boxes for us and let us take them to our classrooms and have them and pass them around to each of our schools that we're doing this unit, and then deliver them back to the museum. So there are all kinds of different ways where you might could get a hold of some artifacts and not have to spend a lot of money.
We will often have people that are interested in making donations to the museum and the memorial. And when it is an artifact, that is something that we have any of, our curator will often advise folks that they should look into working with teachers and working with local historical societies, because it is something that teachers can use to great value within their classes. So those are some excellent ideas. Another thing, if you are within a 50-mile radius of the museum and memorial, that is something that we have. We have trunks that are available for teachers to borrow. But it's wonderful to know that some of the institutions near you have things that are similar that they can work with. And it really is something to consider investigating in your area to see what is available. Oftentimes, museums and other cultural institutions have some really tremendous resources, and folks are simply not aware of the programs that they have. And I am going to use that as a segue into talking about some additional resources for the classroom and as you are learning about World War I and teaching your students. But please do stay with us if you have questions for Carol or for myself about World War I teaching resources or any of the great things that Carol's presented today. Please put that into the Q&A section and we will be getting back to those in just a moment. We've got lots of resources here, and we know that even at this late date that a lot of districts are still making those decisions about what the 2020-2021 school year is going to look like. And so a lot of folks may be doing a hybrid type of teaching situation. Some folks may be completely virtual. And so a lot of the different resources that we're going to talk about are hopefully those that you can employ as you are teaching digitally and make that a little easier. Let's take a look to want to mention again our fantastic funders, because programs like this webinar would not be possible without generous support, like a major sponsor for professional development comes to us from the United States World War I Centennial Commission. They've been doing some tremendous work to raise awareness about the United States' role in World War I and the enduring impact and the need for World War I education. This work, of course, includes a second National World War I Memorial in Washington, D.C., and I just love that Carol's former student is the artist behind this. Such a tremendous honor, and really makes it even more meaningful as we take a look today at that new memorial. And if you are interested in taking an even closer look, there is a new app that has been created, and you can find out more about that and how to download it so that you can get a virtual tour at www.1cc.org, which will take you there to the World War I Centennial Commission's website. Another project that I want to make mention, this is something that is going to go live next week, worldwar1changedus.org. which is a fantastic new educator toolkit that has been created with the World War I Centennial Commission, along with other partners, the Gilder Lehrman Institute, also National History Day, and ourselves, the National World War I Museum and Memorial. We have put together different film pieces, about 7 minutes in length, so they're wonderful. Especially if you are working with students and doing a type of flipped classroom where they are coming into class prepared ahead of time, great for that. There are also primary sources that you can have your kids work with, podcasts and also lessons and activities. This is just a peek of one of the films, World War I, Coming Home. Now, from our website, we have the resource database that Carol mentioned. This is going to include a huge variety of different resources, lessons, full units that have been created, articles, interactives. What's great is that it is a searchable database, so you can kind of take a look at those specific grades that you are interested in, the different subject, the type of resource that you're looking for. We don't believe in reinventing the wheel. We know that there are some wonderful resources that are out there. We have partnered with these folks, and we are excited to present some of the very best resources that exist. We like to think of it as a one-stop shop for all of your World War I resource needs. And included in these resources is the lesson that was mentioned by Carol that she created for us, Animals of the Great War, and the impact of animals during World War I, which is really a sensational lesson and wonderfully engaging, especially for those students who may not think that they're interested in World War I, this is a great way to grab attention and draw those students in. Another piece that we partner with the World War I Centennial Commission on is understanding the Great War newsletter. This is an e-newsletter that is bi-monthly, always features a central theme. And again, it's going to be a variety of resources that come from different institutions around the world, offering background for the teacher and also activities for students. Just a wonderful resource for learners in general. Our next newsletter is going to be available next month, and it's going to address the 19th Amendment. You can sign up to receive these directly in your inbox, or if you are interested in back issues, we have the full archives that are available on our website. Something else I want you to be aware of, we have an online collections database that makes available all sorts of records that have been digitized. More than 40,000 images, letters, journals, diaries, documents that are available in our collection. Again, it is searchable and a wonderful resource for your own research and for your students' research, all available online. What I would like to do now is I would like to see if we have some questions from folks. Carol, how are you feeling? Great job. And I miss teaching this unit. I'm so glad that we heard from Vanessa. Thank you for being with us today. From Stephanie, I have been on the World War II Museum and they have now put up lesson plans for teachers on their site. Just found you guys and started to look at your site. Do we have an education site for teachers? So hopefully some of the things that we just spoke about are going to be useful for you, Stephanie. And if you have additional questions about anything specific, please, you can always feel free to reach out. Our email is pretty simple. It is education@theworldwar.org. Always happy to answer questions. And from James, I purchased 10 artifacts to use with my students this year. What is the National World War I Museum's advice for handling artifacts, gloves or no gloves? Well, we have a program that we do as a public program. We have put it on hiatus for the moment because of COVID and concerns, but we offer it. It's called Hands-On History, and it is an opportunity for the public to interact with artifacts. They are from our non-ascension collection, and so we are able to be a little more free with those, and we do not require gloves, so we do ask that folks use hand sanitizer before handling artifacts and after. But for pieces that are part of the collection, if you were to come here and do research, as an example, in most cases, you would be using gloves, yes. And certainly our curator and our archivist and other members of our collections team definitely will be using those white cotton gloves. And Carol, question for you.
Yes.
I know that in the activity that you talked about today, how do you do that with students?
Oh, we very, very much we use gloves. And if you look at the lesson there's an artifact lesson that John Heeg did for the museum that talks about using artifacts and becoming a historian and thinking like a historian. And it goes through the steps and using the actual materials and the tools that a historian would use. And so we use gloves. And of course, again, teaching fifth and sixth grade, they get very excited about that. But one of our teacher fellows that teaches high school also used gloves. And she said her high school students, it still really changed the atmosphere of the classroom when she pulled out those gloves and it made it really seem like these are really important, you know, items that I'm getting to touch and handle. And anytime we can have students really step into that role of being not just a student, but I'm acting as a historian or I'm acting as an archaeologist and wearing the gloves. And we talk about the fact that we never use pens. We only have pencils. There's, you know, other kinds of rules that we would follow if we were coming and working in the museum, like you would say down in the collections. Follow those same rules, teach them what those rules are, and then model that for them and then let them do that. I think it just really changes the atmosphere in the classroom and it makes them more excited about it. And I think it also helps them treat your artifacts a little more carefully.
Great. Another question that we have, very interested in thematic teaching. I feel pretty covered with language arts and social studies, but floundering with what to do about math and science. What are your recommendations for a World War I unit that would address STEM issues?
I very much think you could work in some of the idea of this razzle dazzle. This book here talks a lot about different kinds of approaches and problem solving that's part of the scientific method. So you could do that. You could use the scientific method with that idea of problem solving. All different sorts of inventions and innovations that came out of World War I that a lot of people don't even know about, in addition to like poison gas and the use of airplanes and U-boats, we also have the pocket watch, or going to the wristwatch. We have cameras being used for the first time, prosthetics. So you could look at innovations in medicine and things like that for that science part. Of course, jumping into the 1918 pandemic and doing any study of that going along with World War I, especially if you're looking at World War I from an American history standpoint, because more people died of the flu in 1918 and 1919 than did in the war itself. And then from a math standpoint, we did find a couple of little math activities that we used as bell ringers. Several of them were like plotting on a grid, sort of like Battleship, and looking at where different targets would be. And then some of them were figuring out rations. And if you're allowed to have this many rations and you've got this many soldiers and that sort of thing. And we found those activities on it was a British website. I can't remember what it was now, but you could probably search like ration, math ration activities and find something along those lines. But it's a little harder, but you can definitely pull some other things in.
Those are some really excellent ideas for being able to blend those other topics in. It can be difficult as you're trying to address the full gamut when it feels really suited to especially social studies and language arts, but I think that those are some really simple ways to be able to blend those other concepts into a unit. Thank you for that. Let's see, we also have, I want to make sure that we are not forgetting any questions that are here. We talked about being able to abbreviate the unit earlier. And I have a question for you, because you are definitely my go-to person who always knows about the most recent films that are World War I related, that are geared for a younger audience, and by all means, so knowledgeable about children's literature that is available for World War I. How do you keep up with it all? What is your secret for knowing about all of these wonderful titles that are being published in just a flood right now?
Yeah, well, Amazon is my friend. My husband doesn't really think it's my friend. but a lot of times we'll just, type in World War I children's books on Amazon and see what new things have popped up, or type in a book that I already have, or by that particular author, and see if they've come up with something new. We got at my school, I already have a pretty good collection of my own, but we were fortunate enough to get a grant to purchase a lot of children's books for World War I. And so each of our classrooms, we have four GT classrooms in our district, and we were able to sort of fill in and get a complete library for each of those classrooms. And we probably have 30 or 40 children's books, all having to do with World War I. Some of them aren't that great. Some of them seem to tell the same story, and some of them are fabulous. Some of them, like this one, Finding Winnie, I know you've got this one in the museum bookshop, is a Caldecott winner. You know, you find ones that you like, ones that speak more to you. At the National Council for Social Studies, where we saw each other in Austin this last year, there was an author that came out with a new children's book then about Mexico. I think it was Mexican Americans involved in World War I. And that was a topic really that I hadn't seen a children's book about yet. And so that book was being debuted there at that conference. But yeah, just try to keep shopping. Anytime there's a museum, I go to the bookshop first or the bookstore first and see what they have.
And it's interesting too, the tremendous diversity that is available, especially within children's books right now.
Right. There's a number of, not just children's books, but there's graphic novels as well. Not as much kid-friendly kind of movies. I think Stubby is the best one. That DVD on War Games is also excellent. It's about 25 minutes long. It's not a full-length movie. And then War Horse, of course, which has been out for a while. And I know that from talking to some people at the museum, it's not the most accurate of stories, but it still is really engaging for younger people. More appropriate for junior high, probably, and some middle school students, maybe not as much for elementary, just because they would be upset by the horses getting killed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, most definitely.
And then most of the other newer World War I movies would be not appropriate at all for upper elementary or middle school students. But I recommend them to parents, because my parents have often gotten very interested in what we're studying about with World War I, especially after they come with us on the field trip to the museum. And so I'm able to offer that information to them. And of course, then they can decide if they watch something, if they want to show it to their children or not.
And that is a very valid reminder that not everything is appropriate across the board, especially you will know your students best, but to be aware that some of these stories do not have the happiest of endings. These address war very realistically often. And a reminder too, even as you look through our online database, our collections database, to be careful how you have students approach it. Take a look yourself first. While there is never anything that is explicit that would be included there, again, some of those images or horses or dogs, as an example, may be very challenging, especially for our sensitive students, to find some of those that take a look at some of those very real repercussions of the battlefield. So an excellent reminder. Thank you so much, Carol. And as I am looking, I am seeing that we are running out of time. So what I would like to do is take a look and remind you that we do have additional webinars that are coming up. Take a look here, and you can find these also on our website. Next week, we have World War I, the Paris Peace Conference and the Origins of Global Feminism with Dr. Mona Siegel. And Thursday of next week, we have the Women's Hour, Our Fight for the Right to Vote, with very special guest, Elaine Weiss. These will be 1-hour webinars. Of course, our webinars always begin and run from 3:00 to 4:00 Central Time. So we hope that you are able to join us, and you can always find out about other activities that will be happening there on our website as well. You will receive an email from us in the next few days that's going to be asking you about your experience here. We'd love to hear your feedback. We would also be sharing some resources that we talked about today, and also you will have the opportunity to get a professional development certificate from us recognizing your participation in today's webinar. You will need a password for that. It is Arkansas 30, that is with a capital A. It will be case sensitive. And so we welcome you to provide your feedback about what we have done. I cannot thank our guest, Carol Huneycutt, enough for her wonderful time and her expertise and for sharing both of those with us today. Carol, thank you so much for being a part of today's webinar.
It's my pleasure.
Again, we thank you all for participating with us, and we look forward to seeing you again soon. This is